We are going to start this Kriyapada Parichayaha, the special session today.
Namaskar, Guru.
Well, I'm going to put everybody on lecture mode, and I'll open for the questions in between. Namaskar. So Kriyapada Parichayaha, overview of verbs. So we have about 1.5 hours, less than that. So my plan is to go through this like in about hour and 10 minutes, and then we can have interactive discussion or questions. We can also have questions in between. But I would really like to finish all the slides, these slides today. I don't want to extend it to the next week. I thought of having this Kriyapada Parichaya, overview of Kriyapada, being useful here today at this junction of study, especially for L1 and for L2 also. Because L1 is going to start the entry into Kriyapada, study of Kriyapadas. But before that, if we know where we stand or where these Kriyapadas fit into the overall structure of the language, and also how they are structured grammatically, so that would give a better idea and a clearer picture while pursuing this study instead of just blindly reading the Kriyapadas or the vakya sentences. Okay. So let's start. So in Sanskrita Bhasha, a sentence is the basic unit of the language. It is considered a basic unit because the language is used. What is the purpose of the language? Purpose of the language is to convey some meaningful expression or idea from one person to another person. For that, the basic unit is vakyam. When a sentence is uttered, then the meaning is conveyed. A full sentence has to be uttered. So when we just say a part of just one word, like one word could be Rama or Surya or Kapihi, anything, that most of the time does not mean anything. When we say just Ramaha, it either means Ramaha Asti, means Rama exists, Rama is there. That also is a sentence, so that Asti is assumed there. Just Ramaha indicating the identification of a Padartha or an entity, it just identifies, but also it means that entity exists. So that conveys the full meaning by adding a verb there. Ramaha asti. Just Ramaha. Okay, what about Rama? The question is Rama running, Rama sleeping, Rama going, Rama just breathing. So the action is important there, so including that asti means exists. Existing action. So a vakyam is a basic unit in Sanskrit Bhasha. We are not talking about any other Bhasha here, but because different Bhashas may have their own definitions of how to convey. So we'll just talk about Sanskrit Bhasha, just the scope is about this Bhasha. In this Bhasha, the vakyam is the basic unit. And some examples are shown here. Ramayana Mahayana. We are all familiar with many of these vakyams. So anything we use is a vakyam. And we already read about shlokas, etc. So everything is a vakyam. Ramayana Maha, which is conveying a meaning. Marutihi Ramam Namati, Suryodaya Bhavatra, Krishna Balarama Upriyadataha, Sahana Bhavatu. Anything is a sentence, vakyam. Now, correct. Now, the next is that in a vakyam, in the Sanskrita Bhasha Vakyam or sentence, there are only two types of words which are assumed, which are considered to be usable. Usable means only there are two types of words that exist in Sanskrita Bhasha. This is by definition. So they are verbs and nouns. They are known as Nama Padam and Kriya Padam. Okay. They are Nama Padam and Kriya Padam. So Nama Padam means nouns, Kriya Padam means verbs generally. Considering the English language. So, Nama Padam, they refer to the nouns or the entities themselves. For example, in this case, in this example, Swihamartihi, Ramam, Suryodayaha, Krishna Balaramam, Shanashaha, Kanashaha, Vidya, Artham, Cha. So, these are all Nama Padam or nouns. Now, the other words, the words indicating the kriya, where the action is happening, kriya means action. So they are the verbs, or kriya padam. In these examples, kriya padam are namati, abhavat, kridataha, and here there is a combination, and the word is avatu. And here it is sadhayet, etc. These are the examples here. So there are two forms. I mean, there are two types of words in each of these sentences. Nama Padam and Kriya Padam. What about the first one? Ramaya Namaha. In Ramaya Namaha, both Ramaya and Namaha, both are Nama Padam. And Asti, Athava Astu, could be the Kriya Padam, which may not be spelled out or explicitly written there. But it has to be assumed. And by definition, in a vakyam, there is always a kriya padam, because that is the base of the heart of a sentence in a Sanskrita vakyam. If it is not explicitly indicated, we'll assume either asti, astu, bhavati, etc. One of it exists, bhavati, exists or happens, or astu, let it be, Ramaya Namaha. So such simple existential verbs are assumed. If it is not explicitly indicated, then only the meaning becomes complete. Right? Ramaya Namaha. Nama means the salute to Rama. So what about salute to Rama? Let there be salute to Rama. So then the sentence is complete. So now we are not going to discuss about Namapadas. So Namapadas, many of you already know the Namapadas. Basically, each Namapada has a base word, like in both the classes we have studied base word, like Rama is the base word, and each base word takes the 24 forms with the Vibhakti tables. So each word has a base word which is called Pratipadikam. This is a grammatical term. Pratipadikam is the grammatical term for the base word of nouns. Nama padasya mula padamasti pratipadikam. Each noun takes like this 24 forms in the vibhaktis, pratyayas, and we can use these different, and that is ekavachana, dvivachana, bahuvachana, prathama vibhakti to saptami vibhakti, and each form we can use in a certain role in a vakyam, depending on whether it is a subject, object, or location, etc. But since we are, this session is specially about Kriyapadam, we'll talk about more about Kriyapadam. And these are the examples of the Kriyapadam here. Namati, Shrunoti, Chorayati, Krinati, Patishyati, Namami, Gachatu, Bhavet, Gachati, Nrutyati, Vijayate, Karoti, Drakshati, Vande, Kurya, Babhuva, etc., etc. Now, you might also come across in your different shlokas or padyas or sentences different forms of kriyapadas, and they all look the same. They don't look the same format. Like everything doesn't look like namati gachati. So many of them look similar, like namati gachati, khadati, patati, etc. But many of them, they are different. They look different. Like for example, here we have drakshati. There is a ch in between. There is karoti. It is not. There is a o karo. Yeah. And here it is vijayate. There is no t at the end. There is a te at the end. Here it is something different. One day. There is no t te, nothing here. And here it is different. Kuryat. That is art. And here it is. This is some alien looking. Babhuva. There is no A, E, T, T, etc. And here it is tu. It is me. So, how are these different forms and what? How are these structured grammatically? You know, how to identify these different forms? The meanings, obviously, we need to know for these different verbs. But what are these different forms? What is the basis of these different forms? So that might be the question, which is seemingly confusing. Again here, one thing to, I would like to remind that the very basic formula of a word, should have written padam here. Padam in Sanskritam. There are two types of padam, and padam is always equal to prakritihi plus pratyayaha. This is a universal truth. There is no exception to this. This is a basic formula. So padam is equal to prakritihi plus pratyayaha. Universal means in the Sanskrit universe. Prakritihi plus pratyayaha. Prakritihi is, these are all the technical terms or the grammatical terms. Remember that. These are not just loose words, which if you look up the word prakritihi or pratyayaha in the dictionary, they will have different meanings, different means, multiple meanings. But in the Sanskrit grammar, that is Paniniya grammar, which is the base of current Sanskrit usage, in that, many technical terms are very precisely defined. So when we say prakritihi, if you look up the dictionary, it might mean the nature or one's own health or something like that. So we are not going, this is not that meaning in the grammatical terms. In grammar, prakritihi means just the base word. Prakritihi is the raw form of a word. Any word, it could be namapadam or it could be kriyapadam. The base form or the raw form is called prakritihi. And a suffix is added to that raw form, raw word, to derive the final form which can be used in a sentence. That is a padam. Padam is the form which can be used in the sentence. Now, in case of namapadam, so this formula or this equation is true for both namapadam and kriyapadam. But when we consider namapadam, this prakritihi, this equation is still valid, but the prakritihi is called pratipadikam. So, pratipadikam is a type of prakriti, but it is called pratipadikam in case of namapadam. then we add a pratyaya to it. That pratyaya is called vibhakti pratyaya. The pratyaya which is added to a pratipadikam, which is the base or the molar padam of a nama padam, it is called vibhakti pratyaya. Vibhakti pratyaya in the grammatical term, it's also called supratyaya. Why is it called supratyaya? So we have seen it in different other classes, so I will not touch on that right now today. So just understand that vibhakti pratyayas, there are 21 vibhakti pratyayas, and that group is called supratyaya gana, so group of supratyayas. So one of the supratyayas we add to namapadam, sorry, we add to pratipadikam, then namapadam is derived. Just for example, here Rama is the pratipadikam. Rama is the pratipadikam, and we add one of the supratyaya called su. Okay. Called su. And that finally results into the form vibhakti, prathama vibhakti ekavachana form, prathama vibhakti singular form called Ramaha. So in between this Rama plus Sum goes through multiple steps before it comes to this final form. So these are the grammatical steps which in your other grammar classes, advanced grammar classes or Paninia grammar classes, etc., you may want to explore actually what are the steps. As far as the language is concerned, that may not be if somebody doesn't know these steps, it doesn't matter. It is important to know the final form. Now, dhatuhu plus, then the coming to kriyapadam. Similarly, this equation here, padam equal to prakritihi plus pratyaya, holds good here too. But in case of kriyapadam, which is the final form of a verb which can be used in a sentence, so the prakritihi is called dhatuhu. Yet dhatuhu is a type of prakriti. A prakriti can be of two types, pratipadikam or dhatu. Pratipadikam is the name given to the prakriti in case of namapadam, but dhatu is the name given to prakritihi in case of kriyapadam. So dhatu is the raw or the base word, mulapadam, for deriving a kriyapadam. To the dhatu, again we add a pratyaya. In this case, the pratyaya is called akhyata pratyaya, to derive a kriyapadam. This akhyata pratyaya is also called thing pratyaya. So thing pratyaya is again a group of pratyayas. There are 18 thing pratyayas. One of them is added to arrive at a certain form of a kriyapadam. So the very basic kriyapadam, most of you know, is already asti, for example. Asti. If you take asti, there the dhatuhu. Dhatu means the base word is as. As is the dhatu. And we add a pratyaya there called ti. Ti is one of the thing pratyayas. So when we add, it becomes asti. So just like here in the namapada case, the base pratipatikam was Rama, and we add a visarga to make it Ramaha. But the visarga is a supratyaya. Visarga is a pratyaya. But this, how Panini defines a visarga in its original form. First, it is not a visarga. That is how Paniniya Vyakarana starts it. So this visarga, originally, for the prathama vibhakti ekavachana, the pratyaya is su. That is what he defines. Then the su changes to visarga, and finally, visarga is added to Rama, and then it becomes Ramaha. Similarly, here in the case of kriyapadam, as is the dhatu, and finally we want to arrive at the kriyapada rupam asti. So to arrive at asti, we need T here to add T. Just as is the dhatu, T is the pratyaya. That is how we want to. But Paniniya grammar doesn't directly define T as a one of the thing pratyayas. So he defines the pratyaya as tip here. Tip as a pratyaya for the ekavachana form of this as. Then this tip goes to different steps and it changes to ti, and then finally you add ti to as, then it becomes asti. So this is the general process of derivation of a nama padam or kriyapadam, final form of kriyapadam. Some of you know this gacchati or gacchatu also, or astu, for example. Astu, like gacchatu, is astu, means let it be. Asti means it exists, it is, but astu means let it be. Here also we have two, the dhatu remains same, as, and then we want to add tu here, astu. Again, Paniniya Vyakaranam starts with tip as the starting pratyaya, and it goes to different steps and makes it tu at the end. Then it says that just add this tu to this as, so then the final form becomes astu. So it is important to know the final form, because that is what actually is going to be used in the vakyam, and to convey the meaning from one person to another person. So this is the important, this is the language, this is not the language, this is the grammar part of it. It helps to know the grammar, it helps to understand the steps, and sometimes or many times it helps to remember the final form also. Because nowadays we do not use Sanskritam as very widespread language, so we may not immediately recall the final forms of the word to be used. So many cases, if we know the derivation part, grammatical part, it helps. However, this is what matters basically for the final form, whatever nama padam or kriya padam. The final form is what matters, and that is what we use in a vakyam. So the final forms are there, like Ramaha, Rameshu, Kapinam, etc., and the Kriyapadam Asti, Astu, Patati, Patet, Gacchatu, etc. This is the language. This is the natural. Language is natural, mostly. But this Vyakaranam is a Krutrimam, that is artificial. Vyakaranam is a made up to give a structure to the language. So we start with all these artificial dhatus and pratipadikam, and then add these artificial pratyayas, and then come or derive the natural padam. Come to the derivation of the natural word, which is in the natural form, like usable form. So for the kriyapadam, the root, how it is structured, is that we just saw some examples. In the grammar, a kriyapadam is structured as a dhatu plus a pratyaya. A pratyaya, which is also called a thing pratyaya. This concept of dhatu is very important in Sanskritam. Dhatuhu. If you look up the dictionary, dhatuhu means the core strength. So here, dhatuhu literally may not mean dhat, like prakriti means like nature, etc. Here these are the technical terms. Prakriti means raw form. So here also dhatu means the raw form of the base form of a kriyapadam. But if you look up the dictionary, it means the core strength, like dhatu, like there are sapta dhatu, santi, etc. So here actually it might mean that it is similar to that. This is the core strength of the language, of Sanskrit language here. Dhatu is very central to the structure of the Sanskrit language here. So dhatu, from the dhatu, not only the kriyapadas are formed, and ultimately the namapadams are also derived from dhatu. The dhatu is very, very central, very, very core to the Sanskrit language structure. So how the namapadam are derived from dhatu? We said that pratipadikam plus pratyaya becomes namapadam. But pratipadikam is not dhatu, right? So how is the namapadam derived from dhatu? So actually dhatu not only takes the akhyata or ting pratyaya, dhatu might take other types of pratyayas also, like krut pratyayas. So when we add krut pratyayas, that becomes a pratipadikam, then we can add a vivakti pratyaya to it, then it becomes namapadam. So dhatu need not always take ting pratyaya. We can add other types of pratyayas which are defined in the grammar. For example, krut pratyayas, like tavatu, tumun, etc. When we add them to dhatu, then it generates a new pratipadikam. And then to that pratipadikam, we can add other vivakti, like normal vivakti pratyayas, then that becomes namapadam. So, most of the words, and there are some debates or paksha, different opinions. As per one opinion, this all the words in Sanskrit language, they are derived from dhatus only. There is no word which is not derived from dhatu. But at least even if we accept that some words are not derived from dhatu, even in that case, more than 99% or 99% almost, they are from dhatus only. There are very, very few words for which dhatus may not be known as of today. So now I'll stop. I'll take a break. Quick, 2 minutes break. Any question here?
Apart from akhyata pratyaya, we have to add vikarna pratyaya also for dhatu, for the complete work.
So, till now, whatever is explained, is there any question?
Yes.
We don't want to jump ahead ourselves, confusing everybody.
So, like with the astu, asti, astu, is da tu, like to, that it makes it to be?
What was the last sentence? Asti, astu?
In terms of that, with the da tu, is that like, you know, when they say ta-da, or something is that like da tu, you're making something? Or letting it be?
Can anybody help me to understand the question?
Talking about tathastu.
Tathastu?
Tatha astu, she said.
Okay. Sorry, I was not able to. So is that what you said, Uma? Tathastu?
I'm not sure made any sense, but in terms of the dhatu, you know, the word, is that because, you know, when you said asti and then you make it astu, that means let it be.
Yes. Yeah, the meaning changes. Meaning changes, yes. Asti and astu, meanings are different.
And asti means it is. And astu means let it be.
Yeah.
The dhatu is us there. Us, he is adding ti and tu. So that is what it changes.
Correct.
The dhatu is the us.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So us and us is the dhatu remains same. And ti and tu, different pratyas are added in different context. Yeah, we'll come to this a little bit in the next few slides.
You also said, Mahodaya, you also said that sometimes dhatus can be used to create namapadam?
Yeah, that is what we saw in the yesterday's class, right? When we added tavatu.
Oh,
so, like most of the words which we use today, they are originally derived from dhatus, which we may not realize actually. So like yesterday we saw patitavat, that is obviously derived from dhatu patitavan, which we already know that is derived from dhatu. But even words like Rama, Krishna, anything, most of these are derived from dhatus only. So though we are saying the pratipatikam is Rama, how is this pratipatikam is coming? That is also derived from Ramadhatu. It is Ramadhatu. From there, first Rama is formed by adding another Krit Pratyaya. Then it becomes Rama. Then we know the table, right, after that.
Can I ask a question?
No? Yeah.
I always thought that Vibhakti is associated only with Namapadam.
Hold on, let me increase my volume, maybe that will...
I can't hear her.
Yeah, hold on.
Hello.
Yeah. Yeah. Vidya Bhagini.
Hello.
Yeah, question, quick.
Can you...
Yeah.
Mahadeva, can you hear me, Mahadeva?
Yes, please.
Yeah. No, I thought that Vibhakti is associated only with a Nama Padam. So now what I understand is that a Dhatu, that is a verb form, is changed to a Nama Padam before we associate a Vibhakti to it. Did I get it right? I'm not too sure.
When you say verb, can you use a Sanskrit word for that?
Verb is dhatu.
Yeah, correct. So dhatu.
Dhatu.
So you are saying dhatu. Repeat the question now with dhatu.
Basically, a dhatu is changed or whatever you say, converted to a nama padam. And then we have a vibhakti, we add a vibhakti pratyaya to it. Is that how it goes?
No, dhatu is converted to pratipadikam, not namapadam directly. Dhatu
okay.
is converted to pratipadikam, then we can add vibhakti pratyaya, just like we already know that.
So that means we still have vibhakti associated only with a namapadam and not kriyapadam. Is that
yes, correct? Correct, exactly. Yes.
Yeah, I was very confused yesterday, Mahadeva, that is why. Thank you.
Vibhakti pratyas are only for added to pratipatikam for namapadam.
Not
for kriyapadam.
Oh.
Yeah, and these are not directly added to dhatus. Vibhakti pratyas are not added to dhatu.
So that is why you are saying when you add certain pratyas, it becomes a namapadam, like the tavatu, and then it becomes a namapadam.
When we add tavatu, it becomes a pratipadikam.
Right, like for example, in pat dhatu.
Yeah.
We add, and then, so that's what it is, okay.
Right. So to add a vibhakti pratyaya, first it must be a pratipadikam. It cannot be added to dhatu. So.
Hmm.
Okay, continuing, sorry, here, these are not necessary right now. Okay, continuing our discussion on Kriyapadam. Kriyapadam, concepts of Dhatu, examples of Dhatus are there, Patta, Churuk, Kru, Kri. Now, where do we get these Dhatus? Like, how many Dhatus are there? Those are the questions. Now, Dhatus, now the concept of Dhatu, examples I have written here, Patta, Churuk, Kru, Kri, etc. Or even us, we saw just now. So, these are Dhatus, which is the verb root, and sometimes I have seen in English books, they call stem. So this is the bit, this very, very unique concept, I think, for the Sanskrit language, where what is pat? It is, we can't just say that it is the Moola Padam of Kriyapadam. So this is a different concept to have. So pat, chur, kru, all these dhatus, they, what they indicate, that they just indicate the abstract layer of a, of an action. For abstract layer, this is, if somebody, if anybody is from the computer background here, they might understand. This is like an object-oriented language, where there is a base class. And from there, different instances are derived. So anyway, so this is an abstract layer. This us or pat or kru, they do not indicate action or a nama padam or an entity or anything directly. So it is just a concept or a thought or an abstract abstraction of that patana kriya. When we say pat, that means reading. It doesn't actually mean reading. Pat doesn't actually mean reading. So from the pat is the base dhatu, and to that we can, on that we can do different processes, different derivations, different prakriya to take it into different meanings. Meanings means different contexts. So whether we want to use it as a kriyapadam to actually say that something did read, someone did read a book, or something is a book, or someone acted as a book, someone let them read a book. So in these different contexts, or someone likes to read a book, someone is very fond of a book, not reading, not a book, someone is very fond of reading, someone is, someone wants to read. So all these different ways, different things, yeah.
Sir, this might be a very basic question, but what is pratyaya? I'm not able to get the equivalent to this.
One second. So, this is a very, this pat can be taken into different directions. Not only the action, but a noun also. For example, to be read, or the one which is read. Etc. All this. So that everything is derived from this abstract layer or abstract this dhatu called pat. So similarly, there is dhatu called chur. So from there, anything related to stealing. Chur means something related, abstraction of stealing. So anything related to that stealing can be derived from this chur. Somebody stole something. Somebody wants to steal something, something which is stolen, something which is to be stolen. So all these different words, not only the kriyapadam, including namapadam, can be derived from this very basic dhatu. The abstract layer of that action. Yeah.
Each of these dhatus actually is kind of the basic for kriya it indicates remains the same, right? Whatever form it takes.
Yes, yes. Kriya, and, kriya remains the same. Like chura is like something to do with stealing.
Okay.
Yeah. And just for the record, some dhatus might have multiple meanings. So just like we have the namapadam have multiple meanings. Dhatus also have multiple meanings in many cases. But your what you said is correct. Like the base thing, what it means in even when it is derived, it is connected to that base abstraction layer anyway. For example, chur means stealing. Anything derived from there is related to stealing only.
Hari Om, Mahodaya, Vivekanand here. The Dhatu, for example, Pat, the Guna Dharma is in the Dhatu itself, but the Dhatu cannot carry out that function. You will need a Karta to do that. Am I right in this?
Yes, correct, exactly. That Dhatu cannot do the action, or it doesn't indicate the entity itself because it is abstract layer. Okay? It's very abstract. So from there we need to do different process prakriya, different steps to bring it to a usable form in different formats. Like whether it could be kriya with the kartru, or it could be kartru itself. So question was, what is a pratyaya?
Yeah.
Okay. Pratyaya in case of namapadam, right? For example, you do you know what is a pratipadikam or a base word, mula padam of a namapadam?
Mula padam is.
For example, Rama.
Rama is Rama. Yeah, Ramaha is.
No, Ramaha is not Moolapadam. Ramaha
Ram,
is...
Ram is a Moolapadam, yeah.
Moolapadam. So that concept you know, right? Yeah. Rama is a Moolapadam.
Yeah.
That is called Pratipadikam. And from where does this Visarga appear? How does this Visarga appear? We have to add a... Visarga.
Ramaha is a Pullingam, right?
Correct. Pullinga. If it is Prathama Vibhakti Ekavachanam, we want ekavachana, we want this form, and to this mula padam, what does that mean? We need to add a visarga, then only it comes into this form, right? We cannot use this mula padam or pratipadikam directly in a sentence. It has to be like pratama vibhakti, ditya vibhakti, tritiya, some vibhakti it has to have. So to do that, you see, for example, if it is Chaturthi Bhakti, what is the Chaturthi Bhakti Ekavachanam? Ramaya, right?
Ramaya.
So here, to the Moola Padam, we are adding this Aya, right? Aya to. So this Aya or this Visarga, these are the Pratyayas. They are the Pratyayas.
Oh, okay.
So in Sanskritam is an inflectional language. What is inflectional? Inflectional means, this is the inflection, like, we are adding a pratyaya to the base word, and the whole thing becomes one word. Unlike in English, to say Ramaya, how do we say? What is the meaning of Ramaya in English?
For Rama.
So how many words are here in English?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
No, here. For Rama.
Here, four is three.
Not the letters, but the words.
Two words.
For and Rama, two words are there.
Yeah, two words.
So, for and Rama. But here, to say the same thing in Sanskrit, how many words are there?
One
word. This for. The meaning of the for is all indicated by this pratyaya called aya, right?
Mm-hmm.
To the Rama base word, we are adding, let's say, aya as the pratyaya. This for meaning is indicated by aya, and that we add this aya to Rama and becomes one word.
Okay.
So that's why it's called inflectional language, because these prepositions which are like for, to, of, in the English language, they stand as a separate words. But in Sanskritam, they don't stand as separate words. They become part of that word, and it becomes one word.
Hmm.
So this whatever we add to the base word, it is pratyaya.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
This is Una. So if you have a base in the noun case of the Prakriti, is that like a dhatu with energy and then you add an ending, making it have some kind of sense?
Yeah, for dhatu and for kriyapada, we'll see. We'll see further what pratyaya we add. We'll see. Now, present tense. Now the different examples we saw, namati, shrunoti, choreti, etc., which are shown here, namami, vande, all these. So now let's get more technical. In any language, there are tenses to indicate when the action is happening. A kriyapada means what? It indicates action in a sentence. For example, balakah gacchati, phalam patati. So here gacchati means goes, patati means falls. So all these indicate the action in in the sentence. In a sentence that indicate action. Right? Now an action has to happen, an action is associated with a time, when it is happening. Whether it is happening now, or it has happened in the past, or it is going to happen in the future. These are the main basic three times we have. So we have basically three tenses. Time is called a tense in English, or kala in Sanskritam, kala is time. So we have vartamana kala, present tense, and bhuta kala, past tense, and bhavishyat kala, future tense. So these basic three tenses we have in English for English kriya, Sanskrit kriyapada also. Sanskrit kriyapada, for that we have three basic kalas. Now the kalas, so let's say this is present and we have future and this is past. A kriya may be happening in the present time, vartamana kala. It might happen in the past, bhuta kala. It might be happening in the future. So here, vartamana kala, which is the present time, has a some window. Present means not exactly happening in this instant. May happen in the next like 24 hours window, something like, depending on how we perceive the time. So anyway, there are three basic kalas in Sanskritam. For the kriyapadas, vartamana kala, bhuta kala, and bhavishyat kala. But in addition to that, we have few more variations of these. For present tense, there is no variation. Vartamana kala is always a vartamana kala. For the bhuta kala, there is a variation of kriyapada. So we are two, actually three types of bhuta kalas, which we will see. And for the future tense also, we have two types of future tense. And then generally, the kriyapadam in Sanskrit, they are known as lakaras. Lakaraha, this is again a grammatical term. Lakara is actually a pratyaya added to kriyapadam to before using it in a certain tense. So for example, if you look at different forms here, patati is in present tense, apathat is in past tense. So we are using this. This one is, I didn't remove this. Patati. Taking this pathadhatu as example here, and this different forms of pathadhatu in the different kriyapada forms of pathadhatu in different tenses are shown here. Example, the first one is pathati, which is a vartamana kala, apathat, which is a bhuta kala, apathit is another kind of bhuta kala, and papatha is another kind of bhuta kala, patishyati is bhavishyat kala, future tense. Patita is another kind of bhavishyat kala. Patatu, so patatu we'll see. But this patati, apatat, apatit, apatha, patishyati, patita, you see here, these actually indicate the kala, when the kriya is happening or happened or will happen. So if this form is there, then it indicates present tense. Kriya is happening now or within that window. And if it is, this form is there, this indicates kriya has happened already in the bhuta kala, but also there is a variation which means not today. We have not today. The kriya has not happened today. It means it has happened yesterday or before. In that case, we use this kind of form, apathat, this kind of form. Then if the kriya has, there is another variation like apathit, this is the example, this somebody, someone has read balakaha pustakam apathit, means balaka, the boy read a book. This form indicates, this also bhutakala, boy read a book, but the boy might have, that means the boy has read the book either yesterday or before, it doesn't matter, this is a general bhutakala. But if I say balakaha pustakam apathat, that technically means the boy read the book. Boy read the book, but that reading happened yesterday or before, not today. Today, like 2 hours back, 3 hours back, if he has read the book, then this form is not technically to be used. This form is better, pathit. If the book has been read today. But this means the book might, that reading action might have happened today also, yesterday also, before also, anytime. This is general. Then there is another kind of bhutakala form for when I say balakaha pustakam papatha. That means balaka read the book again. But it means paroksha bhutakala, this is called paroksha bhutakala. That means the action of reading did not happen in front of the person who spoke the sentence. So if I say balaka pustakam papatha, I know a boy who read the book, but he did not read the book in front of me. So I directly do not know. I do not see that in reading. So that is lit. It is called, sorry, I have not explained this lit. We'll come to that little bit in a little while. So this is the form for paroksha bhuta kala. Similarly, we have two forms of bhavishyat kala. One is called patish, in this form, like patishyati, which is general. Means the action of reading will happen in future, in general. It can happen today also, it can happen tomorrow, day after tomorrow, or any time in future, including today. then this kind of form is used, patishyati. Then there is another form of future tense called patita, which means balakaha pustakam patita. When I say, that means the balaka will read the book in future, but that future is not today. It might be tomorrow, day after, any other time, but not like 1 hour from now, 2 hours from now. Then I will say balakaha pustakam patita, etc. So these are the technical definitions, or technically how these are defined. Like patishyati means general future, patita means not today future. It's called anadhyatana bhavishyatkala. These are the technically how these are grammatically defined originally, but in practice these forms are interchangeably used. When I say balakam apathat balakaha, sorry, balakaha pustakam apathat balakaha pustakam apathit, technically it means like this, but that rule is not strictly followed. So which, even if I say balakaha pustakam apathat, technically meaning he did not read it today, but I can use the same apathat even though when the action has happened today. That reading action has happened today. In that case also, I can use apathat, that is fine. So similarly, this also, that interchangeably used. Now these, vartamana kala, bhuta kala, which is here, this is anadhyatana bhuta kala, not today, and this is samanya bhuta kala, general past tense. Each of them, they have the technical terms in Sanskrit grammar. So this Vartamana Kala is called Lat Lakara. Each one is called Lakara here. Lakara doesn't actually mean a tense. It is a pratyaya which is added to a dhatu to make the dhatu usable in that particular sense. So in the sense of present tense, this is lat lakara. So lat lakara means vartamana kala. So now we use lat lakara means vartamana kala. Then lang lakara means lang. Lakara means anadhyatana bhuta kala, not today. The action, past tense, not today. Then the sadharan, samanya bhuta kala, then we use lung lakara. So that lakara, name of the lakara is lung lakara. Then paroksha bhuta kala, the action did not happen or happened out of sight, that is lit, that's called lit lakara, paroksha bhuta kala. And samanya bhavishyat kala is lit lakara. Then anadhyatana bhavishyat kala is called lut lakara. So these are the different names of the lakaras for the kalas, vartamana kala, bhuta kala, bhavishyat kala. But other than these kalas, or the tenses, times of the action, there are few more lakaras used for kriyapadas. These are, in English, I have seen them calling moods. So for example, here, patatu. Balakaha pustakam patatu means let the boy read the book. Balakaha pustakam patatu. So, what does that mean? Balakaha pustakam patatu, let the boy read the book. That is imperative, right? Let him read. So, it doesn't indicate any particular tense or kala. That indicates just the prarthana, or the we are requesting the person to do some action, or we are ordering the person to do some action. So all that is indicated by this kind of form, patatu, gachatu, patatu, etc. And this is known as lakara. Name of the lakara is called lot lakara in Sanskrit. So it could be like it's imperative mode in English. So we have another one in Sanskrit called Vidhiling Lakara. Vidhiling Lakara, for example, Patet. Here, this Vidhiling has it is used in couple of senses. One is, for example, when we say Balakaha Pustakam Patet, it means Balaka should read the book. It means should read. It could also mean Patet. Patet also might mean he might read the book. Balaka Pustakam Patet means the boy might read the book. That also could be the meaning with the same form. Balaka Pustakam Patet might mean the boy must read the book. Or it also could mean the boy might read the book. Both are possible, both the meanings are possible with the same form, Patet, Gachet, Patet, etc. So how do we know in what meaning it is used? Again, the context is important. What the person who is talking, what he wants to convey, whether he wants to convey the must here or the maybe here. Okay, so then we have another form called Pathyat, which is called Ashirling Lakara. The name of the Lakara is called Ashirling. Ashirling Lakara, the form example given here is Pathyat. Balakaha Pustakam Pathyat. That means, that also means, that is a wish actually. We are wishing that the Balaka should read the book. Let the boy read the book. That is our wish. So in that case, we are using Pathyat. So this is another form we are using. Then there is a last Lakara, which is called Ring Lakara. Example shown here is Apatishat for the Pat Dhatu. The Lakara form, Ring Lakara form is Apatishat. So this is conditional impossible, which means actually means could have. For example, when you say Balakaha Pustakam Apatishat, that means the boy could have read the book. That means for some reason he couldn't read the book. It was not possible for him to read the book. Then that's when we use could have read it. He could have read the book if he had money or something like that, or if he was in the library, or if he had known about it, he could have read the book. But for some reason, it was not possible for him to read the book. In that case, we use this could have. Then we use apatishyat. Balakaha pustakam apatishyat. We can also pair it with the reason. For example, the boy could have read the book if he had money. There also, if he had money, but we know that he did not have the money for sure. That's why he did not read the book. So same thing we can combine. Balakaha pustakam apatishyat. Yadi tasya samipe dhanam abhavishyat. That abhavishyat is also this Ling Lakara form only, because it was not possible. If he had the money, he could have read the book. Either we can pair it with the reason form, dhanam abhavishyat, like that, or we can use just a simple one, balaka pustakam apatishyat. He could have read the book. So these are known as 10 lakaras in Sanskritam. The different lakaras, mainly the first 6 lakaras, they refer to the time when the action is happening. The last 4 lakaras, they are the stuck moods or conditions here. Right? So we have imperative and this must have, could have, sorry, must have or could. And then this is a wish and this is a could have. In that sense. Yeah. In this order. Any quick questions on this Lakara, just the Lakara?
So this mood with number 8. Me can also like an order.
Yeah, order, yes.
Okay. It's not something that no uncertainty never, it's an order.
Yeah, uncertainty could be used like maybe order also can, it might also mean the order, because the vidhi, the name vidhi itself means order here, niyama, vidhi means niyama.
Oh, okay. Well, that's nice to know.
May I ask a clarification, Guru?
Yeah.
One clarification. Just like for past tense, it is better to use lung lagara instead of lung. For future tense, using lut lagara is better than lut lagara.
No. So here, in this, if the action has happened any time, it doesn't. We can lung is better, right? So it could happen. It could happen today, yesterday.
Yeah.
Any.
Yeah. Yes.
And similarly here, the sadharana, samanya bhavishyat kala is lut. So this patishyati. Yeah. So that can be used for any action might happen today also, tomorrow also. That is the thing. But
So lung and ready will stick upon.
So for example, sometimes when I send the email notification about the upcoming class, not for our L1 L2, another class, I used like asmakam vargaha shuha bhavita. So I used the lut lakara there, like patita. Asmakam vargaha shuha bhavita. Instead of bhavishyati, I use bhavita. Means I know that is happening. It is not happening today. It is happening tomorrow. So I use this bhavita shuha.
So specific, we have to be specified there.
If you want to be. Nowadays, in the past also, in all this, these are interchangeably used. It's not a strict rule that one has to follow this. But if we know, we can use it.
How would you use the number 9? Ashiling.
Nasiling tha balaka pustakam pathyat athva prayanam. Suppose somebody is going on a journey. Prayanam sukhakaram bhuyat. Bhuyat is like bhavati. Bhuyat is the ashirling form. Bhavati. Bhuyat. Bhuyat means let your, I wish your prayana of journey become sukhakaram, happy.
It's like may God bless you.
Yeah, may God bless you. This doesn't actually mean blessing. Again, don't confuse with ashir means it is blessing. Ashir means wish, it is just a wish. We are saying bhavatah prayanam sukhakaram bhuyat. That means we are just wishing that we are not blessing. Not always wishing. Even the young person also can say to the elder when going, prayanam sukhakaram bhuyat. Let your journey be happy. I wish your journey be happy. We can also use this form also, maybe, right? When we say bhavet, as an alternate. May your journey becomes happy. So we can use bhavata prayanam sukakaram bhavet. That is another. Or bhavatu also we can use. That also means bhavatu, let it happen. Right? Let your journey be happy. So, there are some subtle differences. Especially this bhuyat. Bhuyat is like where the result is difficult. Like suppose somebody is going on a long trip where they might find some happiness is not guaranteed, like when they're going, especially in the olden days. They are going on a long Tirtha Yatra by foot, and then they don't know where they are going, what kind of they encounter. So we are wishing that, positive wish, let their journey be happy. Bhavata prayanam sukhakaram bhuyat.
How would we say, may you be successful? Whatever task they are doing. like may you have success.
But see, we do not, again, we don't have to translate as it is. We can say bhavatah phalam
karyam
karya siddhi bhuyat.
Karya siddhi bhuyat. Okay.
Okay, here are some examples. I don't think we'll be able to finish today if we don't extend the time. But let's see how much we can finish. So, here are some examples given here. Pat is the dhatu we have seen. And this is the table. Every dhatu gets this kind of a table in every lakara. Right? Remember that. We saw 10 lakaras, different senses, like different kalas and different, like different modes here. So every lakara, for every lakara, every dhatu takes this kind of a table, one table. So this table shown here is for the first lakara, Vartamana Kala, this one, Vartamana Kala, Lat Lakara, which is called Lat Lakara. What is the table for this Pat Dhatu for Lat Lakara? This is the table. So what this table contains? The rows contains Purusha, what is something called Purusha, and the columns, as usual, they contain the Vachanam. Just like the Vibhakti table we have for the Namapadam, the columns are indicate, they indicate the vachanam, ekavachanam, dvivachanam, bahuvachanam, right? And the rows here indicate a purusha. In case of vibhakti table, what the rows indicate? Rows indicate a vibhakti pratyaya there, right? In case of namapadam. But in case of kriyapadam, also there is a table, but this is shorter. This has three columns, but only three rows. So each row indicates a purushaha. Purusha in English grammar, it means a person. So in English also we have first person, second person, third person. Right? So what the first person indicates? When the action is done by me, then the form of the kriyapadam is falls under this row, which is called first person in English, but it is called Uttama Purushaha in Sanskritam. So when we say Aham Pathami, that means Aham is understood. Aham is not part of the Kriyapada, right? Aham is a Namapadam. So Pathami is the Kriyapadam here. Pathami means I read. When Aham is used in a sentence, we must use this kind of, when I am doing the action, we must use this form of the Kriyapadam. If it is Ekavachanam, when I am the only one person doing the action, I should use this, the form which is in this row and this in this column. And the same, if two of us are doing the action, then again, this you, this row, and then Dvivachanam, because two of us we are doing. When many of us are doing more than two, because Sanskrit has three vachanas, ekavachana, dvivachana, bahuvachana, not just two. So if there is one person, one of me is doing this, use this form. If more than one, two of us we are doing, then use this form. If more than two of us are doing, not somebody else, more than two of us are doing the action, use this form. But use the form which is in this row, Uttama Purusha row. So when I am reading the book, I say, Aham Pustakam Pathami. We cannot use any other form of any other column or row. We must use this form when I am doing the action, Aham Pustakam Pathami. Similarly, if I am reading the book with my friend and me, both of us together, we are doing the action of reading. In the present tense, remember, this is the present tense. Then I use this form. So avam is the namapadam for two of us. So I use avam pustakam pathavah. Two of us, we are reading the book. So similarly, there is a group of us. I am also part of it. That is important. If I am not part of it, then it is not we. I should be part of it, part of the group, more than two. So then I use pathamah. So I can use vayam. Vayam is the namapadam. Vayam pustakam. Vayam means we. Vayam pustakam pathamah. So we are reading the book. Now the second row is used. The forms in the second row, they are used when you word is used in the sentence. This you word is tvam here. Tvam in Sanskrit means you. So if you are reading the book, then I can use this form tvam pustakam pathasi. You are reading the book, Madhyama Purusha form. Then if with you there is somebody, there is a friend of yours, and both of you are reading the book together, then I can use two of you. For that two of you, the word is yuvam. Yuvam pustakam pathathah. And there is a group, and you are also included in that. Then the nama padam is yuvam. Then the sentence becomes yuvam pustakam pathathah. So if the words or the action which is done, the action is being done by these words, tvam, yuvam, yuvam only, then we use these forms. If the action is done by I, two of us, or we, then we use these forms. And for everything else, means if somebody else is doing, not me, not you, somebody else, it could be Balaka, Malika, or anything else, Mitram. So then we use these forms. Prathama Purusha form. So Balaka Pustakam Pathati. If there are two boys, then we use Balakau Pustakam Pathataha. There are many boys, then we use Balakaha Pustakam Pathanti. Bahuvachanam. Note that this table or the form of the Kriyapadam does not depend on the lingam. The Kriyapadam doesn't have a lingam in Sanskritam. Kriyapadam has only Vachanam and is Purusha. It doesn't have a lingam. So this makes it a little bit simpler. So even when I am a Purusha or I am a Stri, then also I have to use this aham pathami only. Whether the person who is talking is a female or a male, then this form has to be used. If the tvam is a female or a male, then also this form has to be used. Tvam patasi, that tvam could be female or male. But this form also could be anybody. It could be male, female, balakaha, balika, or the word could be, nama pada could be in napunsakalingam. For example, mitram, friend is reading. For friend, we have a napunsakalinga word in Sanskritam called mitram. So we have mitram patati. So for based on the lingam of who is doing the work, the lingam of the kriyapada does not change. Kriyapada doesn't have a lingam in Sanskritam. It has only Purusha and Vachanam. And these are the examples for present tense only. So if we consider the past tense, then similar to this table which is in the present tense, these forms will be different in the past tense. For example, if you take lang lakara, anadyatana bhutakala, we have apathat, apatatam, apatan, like that. Different, there is a different table. So if balaka, if I say balaka pustakam apathat, then it means boy read the book. So again, depending on this, who is doing the work and how many are doing the work, there will be a table like this for past tense or every lakara of any dhatu. There will be a different table. Any question?
So total 90. It comes 10 into 9 is 90.
So far. We'll see there are more of them.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Yet to go. Go for.
Yeah. Okay. So we can stop here, I think. So we can continue this discussion or topic in the next week. We can stop here today because I think my goal was for the L1 class. In the L1 class, we are going to start this present tense Patati. So I just wanted to give a background. For them, at this point, right now it is fine. But even in the next week on Sunday also, we'll continue this topic and finish it, the rest of it.
How many more slides, Mother?